Welcome back of the 3DN Docs 14SP3 Bootcamp. Today we would like to show you what has changed between the 14SP2 and the 14SP3. And then we will highlight the content manager, the collective spaces, the client tools, isDeploy, and of course DXD. The content manager platform support. So here's an overview of our platform support that we currently have. It's nothing is changed between the SP2 and SP3 release, but I also would like to mention that we still have limited support for the Knowledge Center 2016. It says that limited support ends of July 2020, but we'll give our users a bit more time to actually migrate from a review, from a collaborative review to review space. So give them a bit more time till March 2021. The platform integration deprecation obsolete. So it basically remains the same as the 14SP2, but I still want to highlight that we are deprecating Arbortext editor and also the content or condition management synchronize option that is there. It's hardly used and we would also like to deprecate it. That also saves us time in migrating and maintaining it as well. We also want to have some look at what the inboxes and query folders are used for. Ourselves, we are struggling a little bit with should we maintain it, should we keep it, should we merge it, should we indeed delete it, or have another kind of option. So I created a blog post with a poll, and I'll ask you to code that community and respond to this poll. And also in the comments, if you have a use case why you're using your inboxes or query folders or what brings you the value, please write them down in a comment so we can have a look at it and see how we can continue with the inboxes and query folders. These are basically an overview of what is there in the past and how we actually go from the architect world basically to 3DN Docs. So this is basically the legacy pack and an old component names. And currently you have like a 3DN Docs content manager and 3DN Docs dynamic experience delivery, and the quality assist and content editor were already deprecated. And we also deprecated recently collaborative review and added collective spaces to our portfolio. What's in the box? So this bootcamp basically compares the differences what we have in the 14SP2. And there are some high-level material as well from previous versions that we highlight in this bootcamp as well. So the bootcamp does not contain the content editor, also not the isDeploy commands anymore, and also the quality assist and the legacy content delivery system is not there anymore, and also a collaborative review is gone. For the browser support, so we still mainly support the same browser as 14SP2, but still Microsoft decided to stop support Microsoft Ads, so that's Spartan. So it will still support it till the March 9th of 2021, but after that we will no longer support the Spartan, the Microsoft Ads version, because Microsoft also supports it, stopped supporting it. So that's why we also stop supporting Microsoft Ads after that, that date. For collective spaces. So for collective space, we made a number of small enhancements to make it easier to use collective spaces. So for review space, before we had always a required field for the resolution comment, and now we make it actually optional to put in a comment. Sometimes it does not make sense to put in a comment and people just put a space or a letter in there in order to create this annotation. So there is a setting for this one, and it's basically in the InfoShare collective spaces setting. And then you have to set the annotation resolution command element. There's an attribute required. If you put it to yes, then you still have the resolution command is required to fill in. And it's not out of the box visible, so you actually have to set it now. Also, we hide the label resolution comment if the user doesn't fill in a comment. So that also saves space in the screen, so you can actually see more on your screen about the annotations. Also, the behavior configuration extension menu structure. So we allow multiple custom menus. The out-of-the-box menus that we currently have cannot be changed. And with the behavior configuration, you can actually add extra menus with extra menu elements in the configuration. And you can add the menu references, so you refer to menu items with the ID of the in the behavior configuration element. You also have separators for that one as well, and you can also use it for an expanding group. So this is basically how it's going to look like, or how you can actually do it in your behavior configuration. So you can actually, it is highlighted in this WFXD and the menu item ref for the add remarks. In add remarks, you can actually see that it has a reference for this one. And there you see the label for the add remark, which will be visible then in the menu. And also, yeah, this is basically how it goes and how you can actually define your menu structure in the behavior configuration. For the behavior configuration, we also have now support for a read-only table. We actually call it a read-only narrow table. It's intended for a basic table, so there's no grouping of multiple columns or rows in one, and it can have multiple cells, element names. It's rendered as a table, but it's not a real Fonto table. So the expand table option is not available. So this is basically how it's going to look like, the read-only narrow table. So on the left side, you basically a customization of the data for the bit field values, and that we actually transfer into a read-only narrow table that we understand, and we can also display this one in collected spaces, so in a draw space or review space. It is read-only, so you cannot edit it. For collected spaces, a metadata field, a sort order. So we fixed an issue with data sorting for the metadata fields in the collected spaces. So the old sorting was async or non-sorting was applied. So you were not really know what kind of sorting was done. So that was a bit of a surprise what was returned. So the new sorting behavior is like we saw support a sort order from the metadata configuration and respect a type during the sorting. So you can now better define the sorting in your metadata configuration. There are some other improvements as well for collective spaces. So we also have link resolving for a topic ref and an xref. So in the old way, we did not display the resolved link text. And also the insert dialog shows the full repository. So now we make a small change, and now we can actually display the resolved text, but also still have the options to specify another text if that is required. And for the inserting, the insert dialogs will only show all the items in your current publication. So nothing, not the whole full repository, but only the items in your current publication. The same applies basically for the related links. So the new way is actually that you can make add a new related link. You can also change the title, and also the insert dialogues will only show items, documents in the current publication. There are also some small changes into the notification center. So it only shows notifications from Fonto in there, and also if your search is finished, you can also see it. It's not a generic notification system for Trading Docs, by the way. So it's fully focused more on what's done by Fonto. And also the drag and drop, the move document of content in a document is a little bit easier now by dragging and dropping. We also have support for call tables with multiple table groups. So this is how it's going to look like. For the overlapping of annotations, there's also make it a bit easier to see. So in this example, the train has actually two yellow lines underneath it. So there's also a good improvement. And also for the sharing for annotations, there's now a filter on the share panel. And that one is actually aware of something is filtered out. And all annotations in a topic can be now selected with one click. So you don't have to, if you want to remove them, for example, you can select all of them instead of one by one. We also had support for relationships tables to the product. So the relationships tables is actually disabled by default. And later on, I will show you how to enable it. And after enable it, it's possible to basically have the same kind of mechanism that is available for table support. So you can actually add rows, remove rows. The same applies for columns. You can also move text between one cell to another cell. And also have the option then to have topic references in a relationship table. It is not possible to see and manage a nested topic refs in the header of the relationship table. And it's also not possible to nest topic references in a cell of the relationship table. And it's also not possible to use topic groups. So that those are a few restrictions of the relationship table. And I will show that later. This is basically a screenshot how it's going to look like, the relationships table. The way you actually specify how you can show the relationship tables is also in the InfoShare collective spaces setting. And in the comment settings, you have to say you have to create another element called relationships table with an attribute enabled, and you have to give that the value to yes. And there you can actually show the relationship tables both in collective spaces and also in draw space. It's not set out of the box, so you have to set it manually in this section. For draw space, the browser dialog. So this is basically the old browser dialog. It's not really the style that we would love to have. So this is basically the Fonto style, but we also have our own Graphene style for collective spaces. So this is the new browser dialog. So it looks much more in line what we currently offer. This is basically the repository view, so you can easily navigate through all your the folder structure and specify and click on a specific item. And also the preview is there available. And then you can actually select what you would like into your document. As you saw already in the previous screenshot, you should also see a search there. So we also enhance this new browse dialog with the option to search. It's basically a simple search. It will only do it in the content and like also looking for the title. But you can't do and or that kind of stuff. It's very simple search. And also the result is limited to 25 items in the list. So you have to you can type it in, hit search, and then we'll actually show you the list. And if you click on the list, also the preview is also available. It will show you the title, but also the path. So sometimes you have indeed like duplicate titles. And sometimes you know the pathway actually you want to link to for the particular item. So in that sense, you can easily find your item that you actually want to link to. Here's actually the preview. So if you selected the item in the row, it also generated the preview. So you are really sure you're actually selecting the right topic to insert. This new browse dialog is available when you're inserting for reuse content, also for existing content, a figure with an image, or also an inline image. Also, the search will only show the items that are item types that are based on what needs to be inserted. So if you really want to insert an image, it will only show the illustrations also in the folders, but also in the search. And like I said, so there are a maximum of 25 results, and there's no pagination in this dialogue. What you also improved is the remember folder location in the search query. So if you have the dialog open in select a folder where you actually want to pick your content from, you can close the dialog, open it again, and we'll remember it. We do the both basically for the search is also saved or remembered basically, and also the selected folder. We have a different kind of ways that we actually, we have actually the dialog can be done for multiple, like I said. So also for images or for reuse of content. And for content reuse, inserting existing images of inline images, those are three different types basically of the dialogues. And those are the three different ways of remember it. So if you use the content reuse button, or content reuse browse dialog, if you close it, open again, we will remember it. But then if you use the insert existing document or the inline image, those are not remembered. So you start from basically from scratch, and it will only be remembered if you use the content reuse again, that you will see the remembered folder. And it's only working, of course, in your publication. So if you go out to another publication or another editor, another tab with another publication, it will not be remembered what you did in the other publication. For DraftSpice, we also have a custom sidebar. So the custom sidebar gives you functionality to interact with other applications. So something like a Congry, we can actually send the document and also particular metadata of the document to you. And then you can actually react to it and actually create a nice screen like you see in this example. It's a one way, so we don't actually allow you to update the document, but we only send the information to you. It is the custom sidebar configuration is done by the DSL, but using the sidebar configuration, the extra sidebar elements. You can specify the URL of your application where you need to link to. And you can also say the position. So the position basically on the right side normally start with the outline, and that's number one. And they can actually go downwards or upwards where you actually want to have your sidebar at the top or at the bottom. You can also specify an icon for it, and that one is actually need to be one of the font awesome ones. And also you can have the size, basically the width of the sidebar. So if you click on it and it will open, they can actually choose from small, medium, which is the default, and large. So how to build the application for the custom sidebar. So the custom sidebar will receive information about the selected document and also about the publication. And you need to actually subscribe to the post message. And if you subscribe to the post message, you actually need to check for the type. So you need to check for STL extension sidebar. If you don't do that and you get a lot of events to you that you have to handle, so preferably you only should handle that STL extension sidebar type. The payload that you actually gonna get from us is basically information, document information about the XML, the language card, the logical card, object type revision and the version. And the information about the publication is about the language, logical ID, and version. So just a reminder, we only send the stuff to you. You cannot send anything back, and you cannot update the document in the publication. So it's basically read-only. Document history, FDIF. We also make a small change. So we renamed first version to first revision to make it more in line, basically, with the wording. Also with the document revision ID for released for resolved annotation. So there's a new metadata field, fish resolved revision ID on an annotation card. It's not a mandatory system field, and it's actually used for the annotations to indicate the document revision ID when an annotation is resolved, so we can easily keep track on it. And there's no iWrite plugin configuration to update the field. Like I said, so previous in the previous release, we released document history with Delta XML. Now it is replaced by Fonto's own comparer that's called FDiff. And the future parity is equally to Delta XML. And also the way forward is still using FDiff, because also Fonto would love to have changed from Delta XML, but they won't make those changes. So and now Fonto can also make changes to improve document history with their own FDiff. So we actually tested it as well with the FDiff, and the result is basically the same. So that was also our decision then to completely remove the Delta XML. So it's also improved also from the CD, so you cannot install it anymore. It also has a nice side effect that we can also remove a service from our installation. And also that service, of course, is also using quite some memory. So that is always a good improvement as well. So it also gives us for the future as well, better visualization of the compare results. So because we changed Delta XML to FDiff, also its deploy is adapted completely to work now with FDiff. FDiff does not yet have the ability to exclude certain attributes for comparison. So if an attribute was changed, the whole element is marked as changed. So that is still something we need to work on. So we actually bypassed it a little bit. So we removed the ID in the CID attribute when retrieving the revision for the XML content for document history. So basically they're excluded then for the comparison. So then you probably don't see that the whole element is marked as changed if the ID or the CID attribute were changed. The document history configuration. So there's now an SX XML file, and that defines the elements, inline blocks and tables, etc. And we will provide an out-of-the-box version. So if you have a customer behavior configuration XML, the ish deploy commandlet set ish Fonto schema experience will actually update this new file of FDiff instead of the one from Delta XML of the previous release. So this is actually collective spaces for the training docs 14 SP3. The current picture is actually what we shipped with SP2. So they see still the Fonto Delta XML and the Fonto document history. And actually we remove it, so there's one service less now in the 14 SP3 release. So basically these are the servers now, Fonto review and Fonto document history, and the Delta XML one is removed. This also gives another flow of the document history. So now we actually, if we are in draw space or basically draw space, then we can actually do a get of a document for the history, and then actually you can do a retrieve loop inside basically the document history that contains the FDiff instead of jumping out to another process. So that's also a difference. So it's remains in the same process as the Fonto document history window service. Now it's time for a demo. To log into my system. So basically what was I saying? So here's actually on my system, the relationships tables are enabled, and also the annotation resolution required is yes, that is also now there in the configuration settings. Indeed, for my test, basically I have my own publication. So for training docs, it's an old training docs for the 14 SP1, and I can open this one. And then I can actually start editing my content for in the craft space on my publication. So what I want to show basically that we now can actually do a crosslink. So in the crosslink, I was mentioning that this now actually highlights only the items in a publication. You can select it and then you can press insert. And here you can type a title in there. And this one will be remembered. If you don't like the title or want to have the original title of the link, then you can click on this one. Then it will actually display the title of the topic you link to. If you want to, you can still the preview behaviors as well. Like you can also press show more, then it will actually do a preview of the particular topic. If you double click on it, then it's open. It's to for editing the link. And then it's there, but still you can still press on this icon. Then it will actually show you the link of the topic. And also you still have the options to remove it. You can also do the same one for related links. So here you can still also select one, insert it. And then you can actually see this is your related link. It basically is the same. So by default, it will show the title, but also the double click give you the option to edit the title. Click. Also, you can click on it and then it will actually use the title as it was there originally from the topic. Like I said, we also supported relationship tables. So we now, if in the menu, you can actually define a relationship table. In there, you can actually do give it a title of the column type. Oh, you can also save it and it will be displayed. In there, you can actually add links to a topic, and then you can actually have it open, and they can actually select multiple topics which you prefer, and those are only topics in your publication. So I can then press insert. It will actually put it in there. It is basically the same. So also double click will give you the options to edit. Edit the link. Also, you can actually you can also select an item there. If you select one, you can also actually move it to another cell if you would like to do it. Then it's actually moves to another cell. So if you type it in wrong the first time in the wrong cell, you can easily actually move it upwards or downwards in the relationships table. It's basically the same table. So if you want to insert another row that is still available or on the column, you can still do it. If you want to remove it, it gives you also the option to remove it. So this is the relationships tables, what we introduced for the 14SP 3 release. So this is what I want to demo about. Collective spaces. We continue now with the client tools. So the client tools support platform. So nothing has changed. I just added here like 14SP2 also the SP3 one. So compared to SP2, nothing has changed. We still support the same platforms and client tools like Arbortext, Oxygen, or XMetal. Then we go to a content importer. So for content importer, we make some general enhancements. So we now also give the options to add a friendly import name to the import. So before we only show the folder name. Now there is an extra option to give it a new title. It's not required. If you don't fill it in, you still get the folder structure basically as the title. Also, we improved the layout a little bit. So it's now easy also to delete an import, restart it, or start a new one. We also have a restart repeat successful import. So that is also done by the menu of the card of the import. We also from the community we heard some issues that people have with content importer. So when you're using an import in doing the import, you also from the in folder you also will generate some intermediate format in out folder. And then if they do another import, so another card, and then select those two folders again, then the content importer was complaining, hey, the folder is used by another import. Then people have to go to the file system, figure out the location, delete, and try again. So we added actually buttons to clean up the last import. So we actually removed the output folder data if we actually delete the card, and also it's available in the console application as well. We added buttons for restart and start a new import with the same settings. So on restart basically scans the in folder and compares what's already done and only does the delta. And start a new import with the same settings basically does the import again, but first deletes everything in out folder. So this more or less like a fresh import and everything is imported again. Bit side of imports. So we have some for the standard imports. And also we have then the option actually to delete the import. So you can have many options there to actually to delete the import, and it will actually remove it or restart it. Like I said, so the restart was an incremental import. So only change of edit files are important. But it still is also available when the last import was successful. So you can do it over and over again, the report, and add more items to your to the in folder, and it will pick it up. Start a new import with the same settings. That is actually forcing a new import, but keeps the same card. Basically, you don't get a new card, but will reuse the same card. We actually remove the whole content in out folder, so it will actually reuse the same setting, so the in folder, out folder, but also the location that it is in your repository as well. So all the settings are the same. The only difference is that we first clean up the out folder. Another issue our customers would love to have is basically the option to create a copy of a publication. So the first to the export, the export of a publication with all the topics. And all the related data or all the related maps and images, but still they want to import it with new GUIDs. So sometimes you have like a big organization that is split up maybe in two departments, and they can't agree about maybe the publication of several topics, and each one have their own version. So now you can easily export those topics and import them again with an option to create basically new GUIDs. So we also update the content. So if the topic is referring images and the image GUID is changed, we also update that link as well. So it's also available in the console application. Here you actually have a screenshot about if you want to reuse with the new identifiers. Here's the options to create those new identifiers during the import of the repository data content. So it's not available for the generic data content. So for generate new identifier, so this basically for generic data content, this was already outside of the repository. So we always create new identifiers basically for the import. For the repository data content, we still remains, basically all those links and all those identifiers the same by default. And now actually we have a third option now to the repository data content plus we generate new identifiers. So all the identifiers in objects that have links will also be updated. This basically gives you an overview of all the conversions and all the options and what is supported and what is not supported. So this one gives you also a good overview which one to use and what to expect from it. Also for partial imports, there's still a nice overview what we actually do in case of links to missing images or links to missing topics and maps and corners and missing topics. Not something we change basically. It's just basically it gives you we actually support and what the outcome is. Importing images for the standard import with conversion. It's able to import maps and topics or reference images are not available. So the default content importer does not convert and import a topic or map when their reference images are missing. But there's now actually an option. Some customers will still love to or want to continue with the import. Now we actually have a setting, or there was already a setting, to enable disable the validation check for reference objects. It is manually set in the configuration files. There's no UI in it, so the default is error, so that's why it is always failing. And it's available on the content importer 14 or higher. So basically, this is the configuration setting of the content importer. Then you see the element validation. So it says by default the error. And we have several options for the notification level. There's actually hidden info warning or error. So with the hidden, it doesn't show anything in the UI. Don't lock it, but it will import the source. The same for info and warning, except we actually log the warning or the information, but they still import the source. And with error, we show the error everywhere, but we also do not import the source if that one is missing. A demo on the content importer. So for this one, I have my generic input. So this input and this is my out for normal data content. So here I can actually start the import. I can bootcamp import. So this is actually where I can specify the title. And this one I just copy my, in this case, copy folder location. And make this out. And you can general import bootcamp. And this is basically it. And now I say convert and import. I can actually continue with the import. And it will start actually importing it. Also, this is the in folder. Now you can also see in out folder, we generate a couple of files for doing the import. And also now, if you look at the repository, if I refresh it, the bootcamp will be there. And also the topic is there. And if you preview this particular topic, you can see the content, but also all the images. So this was really a successful import. So if you now actually delete this folder, and then of course you can do a restart, it will detect, hey, not you can continue with what nothing is done because we set things up to date. We didn't import it again. We only do the differences if there are differences. So if you would like to start again, you basically have to go to the out folder and remove everything. So now we also have the option, basically, start new import with same settings. You get a nice pop-up that would actually explain what it's trying to do. So you're about to start a new import with the same settings. This action will delete all files generating during the import. If you now say delete and start, they can also see that in the out folder, everything is removed now. And the in folder basically remains the same. The settings are still the in and out, and the folder is also the same. So in that sense, you can now actually do the import, continue with the import, and it will now basically do the import for you. If now we refresh it, they can actually see that it's this, there again, it's the correct time as well. So everything is still, so I remove this one as well. Come to home. Now we can actually do another import. Now do actually data content from the repository. So I also created some basically the same, but then I exported this as from the repository. And here you have all those topics, links, maps, and images. And here you can actually specify the content, and you can actually say general. Import put camp, and you say convert and import, continue with import, and then it will actually be available in your repository. If you have here your particular topic, you can still see the properties. In the properties of this topic, you can see like the GUID identifier ends on F5. So if I look at this one in my repository in, I can actually see that this was this particular topic, customer F5. So the whole GUID remains the same during this import. And also, like we have the out, so everything is there generated of first converted, and then we actually import it. So now, if I go to my, you also see I didn't put in a title the second time, so you actually see the folder structure. So for this one, I now say also start new import with same settings. It deletes it. So then everything is also deleted from my out folder. So this one is clean again. But now at the bottom, I can have the option generate new identifiers. And it's still also inserted in the same bootcamp place, but you can also specify other target folders as well if you would like. Then I press convert and import. It will continue. And then if I now open it, you can actually see there's a new topic there. And this one is a bit later. So the first one we saw it was F5 as the GUID. And now this one, this new one, has a new GUID, FE. So this gives you the options of all the items that are imported have new identifiers. It's not only to the topic, but also for the maps and images. So this is I want to show actually about content importer. And then we continue with isdeploy. So for isdeploy, we have a new release that is coming out. That is 2.2. So it is still. So if you install basically in the latest version isdeploy, it still remains working on all the versions as well. You can install it from the PowerShell gallery. And sometimes if a particular command lines are not working on a particular version, you will an exception or error, but the command that will be still be available. Like I said, so we actually released isdeploy 2.2. It's using the framework 4.7.2, and still also works on Knowledge Center 2016 and up. But you still have to install the .NET framework 4.7.2 if that one is missing. Also, we made some changes to our out-of-the-box enabled default services. So that one was normally not using isdeploy. So any customizations done in this file, then isdeploy was not really notified with it, and also the whole isdeployment was not working correctly. And also, if one install hotfixes, there's still command lines to stop everything, like you stop your whole deploy. That one is still not really working correctly. Some servers still remain running, which probably prevents you installing the hotfix correctly. So what we actually did, so the enabled default services will now use isdeploy. The behavior is basically the same, so it enabled the same services before. It will only enable one crawler service and actually start all deployment. So, but there's one note at the moment. So for the crawler service, it means that the count of the crawler service is set to one, and the second crawler is removed. So after this one, you have to create a second crawler yourself, basically. So out of the box, we created basically two crawlers. But if you actually run enable default service with now uses it, and actually the second crawler is removed, but you can actually add it later if that is a requirement or needed. So for the isdeploy with some Fonto Delta XML commands, so those commands are still working, but they will raise an exception if you run it on the SP3 release of 14 SP3. If you still use the isdeploy 2.2 on the 14 SP2, they will remain working as before. Also, the set is Fonta schema experience, that command line will now update the FDIF configuration in SP3. But if you run it on SP2, it will update the configuration of Delta XML. Also, the enable is UI collective spaces. That one, if you have the options document history for draft space, if you enable that one, it doesn't enable the Fonta Delta XML service anymore on the 14 SP3. And also the start is deployment. That one is also does not start the Fonta Delta XML anymore on the SP3 release. If you want it on SP2, it will do it. So this is basically the isdeploy prepare Fonta dynamic configuration. So this is basically the whole set is Fonta schema experience that actually remains working. But like I said, instead of updating the Delta XML configuration, it now usually will update the FDIF configuration. And then finally, we got to the dynamic experience delivery, DXD. So this is the highly overview of the architecture of DXD. It still remains the same. So from that point of view, nothing's changed. But yeah, what has changed then in DXD? So with the 3D and 14 SP3, we also release now the DXD 11.5 with it. And actually the big change is actually the GraphQL public content API. It's now extended with search capabilities. And that also will work with 3D docs now as well. And it also fixed an issue on the certificate key, like a deadlock issue that was an issue for a couple of our customers. There are some notes if you're going to use or start using 11.5. It requires some hotfixes on top of 11.5. And also if you're using DXD 2.2, it also requires a couple of hotfixes to run it successfully. If you're running the dynamic documentation model, it will still use the IQ query client and not the GraphQL search capability yet. So it will remain the old one, the IQ IQ Query Client. From the platform support, so not much has changed except for the databases. So now it only supports SQL Server 2019. So 2017 is dropped support for Oracle. It remains the 18.3 and 19.3. For experiments optimization in the during doc sort. So before it was Elasticsearch 6.7 and now it is actually 7.7. So those are the main differences in platform support for DXD. Here's the matrix of the DXD DXA version. So I added an extra row for the 11.5 DXD version and also an extra column for the SDL Trading Docs 14 SP3. So the 11.5 is now preferred on the whole 14 release. So that excludes also SP1, SP2 together then with the new SP3 release. And also for the DXA versions, it's still everything is supported. But like I said, so if you're going to use it with 11.5, you are required to install a couple of hotfixes also for the dynamic documentation module. And this brings me to the end of the bootcamp of the what's new in the Trillion 14 SP3.